Doom and gloom. Someone accused me of being a doom and gloomer. Well, let me just say that I don't want to see civilization collapse. I don't want the civilization to get to a point where we have a breakdown where people lose their lives and their livelihoods. I want to see people prepare for emergencies. Just because I point out a problem doesn't mean I want to see that problem get worse. And just because I want to see things get better doesn't mean it makes sense to actually ignore the potential problems that we're dealing with. Now, I don't know if we're going to look at a dollar collapse or anything like that, but we're going to have some serious problems. For example, with Social Security and that payout, the demographic issues with the birth, a lot less birth, a lot less people coming into the workforce covering these entitlement programs. That's going to be really significant. These are some real problems that just aren't going to really go away. So that's something to think about. Also, you have the debt situation. We have trillions and trillions of dollars in debt. That situation isn't just going to go away overnight. So we have to look at the reality of the matter, and things could get worse. We could end up in a situation where things break down, where the power grid goes down. So let's talk about what we can do to put ourselves in the best position to really deal with that situation. I think we should acquire as much knowledge and information and skills and resources as possible ahead of time, so that if something does happen, we'll be in the best position to actually respond to it. And that's called being proactive. That's common sense, at least to me. All right, what should we do in a scenario where, to really prepare for a scenario where the power is down for an extended period of time, maybe a few weeks or so, maybe you're in a situation where you don't have gas energy for your home and you just don't have heat in your home. What are some of the things you can really do to really prepare for a situation where you can't necessarily go to the grocery store and get food immediately? Well, right off the bat, of course, you want to have, actually, water. Even if you have a nearby creek, simply having water in your house means that you don't have to go outside your house to actually acquire water. And part of that also means having some type of water filter. This is probably the most important thing, more important than food right off the bat. This is something where you can actually put the water in a pouch, screw it on, and squeeze the water through this filter. There's many different filters you can actually go with. Make sure you pull this. A lot of different filters you can go with. This is actually one of the simpler filters. Well, at one point I had a Berkey water filter system, but of course, food. This is a freeze-dried pouch by Valley Food Storage. Pretty good company. It can last up to 25 years, which is really important, which is one of the benefits of this. Also, you can get something made by Mountain House. You can get pouches just like this, or you can get number 10 cans. This is really good for families if you have to feed a lot of people. Something to keep in mind, you need water, at least for these type of food storage. You need water and probably some heat to sort of heat it up as well. So you want to maybe get the water hot or boiled water, but you definitely want, I would definitely want to have some hot water. So something I would want to go with. And how do you really get to that point? Well, there are a lot of different options for that. Here's one option. You can obviously go with a wood stove, but that's the simplest way, definitely, for sure. But you can also go with stoves that are made for actual propane. I think propane is a really good source for heating. It's a stable gas. It's easy to really work with. It's easy to find. That's what I love about that. But anyway, this is a Striker stove made by Campfire. It's part of their Mountain Series. And what happens is you can actually use different fuel sources. With this, you can actually put this little adapter on there, which actually comes with it. Screw it on. Put a 1 pound propane tank on there. Set it up right here. There's a little stand for it. Put the food in there if you want. Even has little measurements in place. I don't know if you can see it, but it's in there. So you can tell whether you're at a half a liter, a full liter, so on. So that's a pretty cool option. Also, for keeping food warm, in case you might want to actually heat up some canned goods, you can use this, of course, but you also, Sterno, might be able to use this for food, Sterno fluid. All I do is heat it up. All you need is just a source to light it up. And it's really good for really just keeping food warm, so that's an option you might want to go with. But You know, if you want to avoid all that and make it really simple, something where you can have everything all in one package, you can go with an MRE. This right here has everything you need, except for the water. Basically, it has a heater where you just pull the water. When you put the water in there, it's a reaction, and it heats up. And it heats up, and it actually cooks your meal for you. So all you really need with this MRE is that just the water, basically. The downside is it only lasts, I think, maybe 5 years. It's rated to last 5 years. It may actually last longer, but it depends on how you really store it. Also, with this, the freeze-dried food, it's really important on how you really store it. The number 10 cans are really good for long-term storage. It's just, you don't have to worry about the pouch being punch or any type of hole in the pouch, so that's pretty cool. Another thing, the power really does go out. And by the way, if you're gonna have stoves of any type, you wanna have some type of fire extinguisher. This is one of the fire extinguishers that I have available. But this right here also runs on propane. Has a little piece right there, you put the propane tank right there, 1 pound propane tank. But anyway, it's a heater. It's an indoor heater. It's called the Portable Buddy Heater. Long time ago, I actually had a Big Buddy heater, which is pretty awesome. This is pretty good. They do warn you that you want to take, when you want to shut it off, you want to cut off the actual propane tank and then let it burn until it's actually out. But I never really did that. But anyway, this is pretty good. If you let it burn at the low setting, it'll probably last maybe 5 or 6 hours, maybe, depending on the temperature, and you know, it's depending on that. But also, if you want to burn it on high, I think it lasts maybe 2 or 3 hours with this one. I think you get a little bit better efficiency with the Big Buddy heater, but it's definitely much bigger. They don't call it Big Buddy heater for nothing. This is awesome though. You can use, what I would try to do is, if I was in the middle of winter and there's a power outage and it's going on for a long period of time, I'd probably try to turn this on for an hour or so, get my room. I'll select one room that I can seal off pretty well. Yeah, I still might have some type of ventilation, but you want to have a CO2 detector, but then there's the issue of the power's out. How is that going to work? Batteries. Make sure you have plenty of batteries. But anyway, I might consider just at least choose one room, you know, choose one room and heat it up for like an hour, then shut it off, and maybe I can sort of stretch the propane a little bit better. So, something I'm consider. I know I've said this many, many times, but I have to say it again. Some basic first aid, basic medical stuff, a tourniquet, you know. This is a good thing to have with you when you go to the range. Here, waterproof tape. That's sort of, in case you have any type of wounds and you gotta keep the bandage in place. Skin stapler, really good idea. Quick clotting agent right here just basically is sort of like a gauze that goes over your wound, and it's sort of designed to sort of help stop the bleeding. The other option right here, a vent, a chest vent for any type of wound, entry wound or exit wound. Obviously you want to have band-aids and gauze and all that type of stuff. That's obvious. Lots of gauze, stuff like that. A SAM splint in case something gets broken, you have to stabilize a limb. Obviously, security when legal, you know, you can get a concealed carry permit, or if you don't need it in your state, great. Either way, I got a Glock 30 chamber and 45, Glock 21 chamber and 45. Got some extra magazines. Now this sort of goes without saying, but you want to have some type of flashlight. You want to have flashlights. You want to have some good ones too. Don't go with the cheap ones because they're not reliable. They're not gonna stand up to any type of heavy use. They're not very durable. It's worth it spending a little bit more on Phoenix, F-E-N-I-X, Phoenix brand. This old light is pretty good as well, but Phoenix, that's very cost effective, and it's also, they make very good lights. Something to keep in mind. I carry one every single day, actually. You can tell I use it. Look how worn it is. But one of a nice bright flashlight. This one actually comes with a rechargeable battery, where you know you can just, you don't have to keep replacing it with batteries. But you still need extra batteries in case you know you're not able to actually recharge something. You need some type of light, some light source that relies on regular batteries in case you're not able to just recharge. So that's something that's really, really important. So you want to have it rechargeable for everyday use. But then you also want to have some lights that, you know, just run on regular AA or AAA batteries in case, you know, you don't have access to a power source. Or you could also get solar power to sort of recharge the batteries. That's an option. But anyway, I have different lanterns. I have a lantern for my vehicle. These actually run off, I think D batteries, actually. So I have extra D batteries as well. So some simple things you can do is just make life a little bit better for you if there is some type of emergency. And, you know, it just makes more sense to just be prepared for emergencies. And so it's not about living in fear. It's not about doomsday or anything like that. It's about common sense, really. So thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. All right, nothing fancy here. Is some of the basic hygiene items you're gonna need. Obviously, super glue. You can use that for a number of purposes. Aspirin or ibuprofen or something like that. Make sure you have plenty of deodorant. Maybe not the highest priority, but definitely some petroleum jelly. You can use this actually to take care of your skin, but you can also use that as a means of starting a fire if it's necessary. Super glue in case you have a wound that you need to seal for some weird reason. Some beans, rice, more rice, popcorn I'm not going to use. Some food, and so like a instant lunch should last a decent amount of time. Lots of fruits in jars, fruits in cans, peaches. Some of the stuff is more temporary. Don't really need chocolate almonds, but hey, why not? You don't need pecans, but hey, behind it, the soup, really important. Some type of soup. I know you got to be careful of the sodium content, but there's more soup back there. Soup down here, progresso soup, some chef boyardee, some beefaroni down here. Again, nothing too fancy. A lot of snacks, but also chili mac. Beef tamales, I love beef tamales. A lot of beans back there. Chili with beans, hot and spicy. Got some veggies back there. Chili, a lot of chicken though. That's some chicken behind that as well. Chicken up there. More chicken back there. Peanut butter. Definitely love the crunchy peanut butter. Beans, got some sausage back there. Corn, peas, some more snacks. Sweet peas, a lot of beans back there though.